Então, if you allow me to use my Greek pronunciation, I would say lessons of vitality. To complete the CV that was presented by by Gordon, it's okay. As an appendix, I have here listed the awards and medals he received. So we have in 1993 from the Slovak Academy. Then we have the prestigious Hydrology Prize, which is awarded by IAS jointly with UNESCO and WMO in 1994. It's interesting to see what Samir, who was mentioned before by Henny, what he said about VIT at the time of the award. He has been known in the hydrological community as one who keeps us honest and one who tells it like it is, without being blinded by passing fashions and flashy new technologies. And in 1995, he got an American award. There, the citation was given by David Dowdy, who said, "I have always prided myself on being the Carmanjon of hydrology, so it is with much regret that I must bestow on it the title of Chief Carmanjon of Hydrology, as well as the Railingsley Award." Some more informal awards. I think the first one for me is very interesting because it explains the question put by Gordon before, why he did not attend, he did not have an academic career. This is a letter from Eamon Nash. I guess everybody knows the name in hydrology. "It is all the most disappointing that a man of your clarity of insight has not been snapped up as a professor of hydrology in any of the many institutions teaching hydrology in the North America." So I believe it was not his choice. Sadly, I believe that academia is more reluctant to host heretic people like Witt Clemmers. This is my interpretation. Sorry. Another interesting award, informal one, is from an American institute for courageous and continuous use of pins against balloons. And another one by Emlyn Howard Lloyd. I think he is a mathematician also involved in hydrological research. He was perhaps, I don't know this person anyway, who says, "I hereby bestow upon you the order of wise interpretation, first class, division of wising up ignorant probabilities." This note is by Witt, and he says, "This is my highest mathematical award ever received." Okay, now about my relationship with Witt Clemmers, and you will understand why I invoked the Thea Tichy, the goddess of randomness, because actually I did not know, of course I know the name, and I knew his work, and I had cited his work, but I did not know him in person. So in 2003, there was a conference in Ascona, which is held every 10 years. It's about hydrofractals. And I had two talks there, and after my talks, Witt, he was there, I didn't know, he introduced himself to me, and I say, "Oh, it's a great honor, it's a great pleasure for me that I get to know you." And he say, "Really, you are glad that you get to know me?" I say, "Yes, I'm very glad." And he said, "Ah, you didn't receive my letter." And when I came back, this conference was in September. When I came back home, I received this letter here, which is about my paper, The Hart Phenomenon in Fractional Gaussian Noise Made Easy. This was my paper, and I had cited Witt there, and he was not satisfied with the way I had cited him, so he complained in this letter. I also learned this thing here, his resolution to stop reading and writing about science, the science of hydrology, by the end of the 20th century. So he didn't know about my paper, but someone gave it to him, so he read the paper and he complained. The paper I cited is this one, and it's a famous paper, The Hart Phenomenon, a Puzzle, 1974. His dedication to me, to Dr. Koutsogiannis, without compliments. So the paper says, of course, it is well known, but it is related to several of the talks here. It is shown that the Hart phenomenon is not necessarily an indicator of infinite memory or a process. It can be also caused by non-stationarity in the mean, etc. Well, what I had written is the above explanation, my explanation anyway, this is my own paper, may seem similar from a practical point of view to that by Clemes, who attributed the Hart phenomenon to non-stationary means. Anyway, so in this paper he had made some notes and annotations, and you can see a passage that I did not give the proper attention, which says, although he writes in the abstract about non-stationarity, here he says the process implodes, can well be considered stationary in the sense that its probability laws do not change through time. And this is the correct definition of stationarity. But he used the terms stationarity and non-stationarity in a more colloquial meaning in the abstract and in the entire paper. So we exchanged several letters after this. I replied immediately, and he replied again immediately, saying, "I'm a good lawyer." So we exchanged by regular mail several letters, and you can see we continued that way until throughout 2003 and 2004. And in the 1st of January of 2005, he writes me this email: in order that we leave the old one, the old year, behind, and this year try to continue our discussion in a more productive way. It occurs to me that we could sort out most of our differences, misunderstandings, etc., in one or two afternoon chats of a direct Socratic dialogue. So I liked, of course, the idea, and he noted that he could come to Greece. So we organized a Greek symposium just to clarify the meaning of the word symposium, because it's a Greek word, symposium. So it's syn means together, and posium is drinking together. It's not making scientific conversations, but could be. Okay, could be, but the important thing is to drink together. And you see, we have realized this symposium, and we continued in for the couple of days in the island, this island in Kefalonia. We have a very old house, and he came there. So there was a competition of ideas, of different opinions, and we had a very objective jury. It was my wife, Anna. And you see, the result is the photo that... so Witt scored the victory, and I took consolation by smoking a cigarette. Okay, so this was our first disagreement about Hart. I believe, well, unfortunately, we didn't end up with a resolution, but this is my interpretation, that we find some common grounds. And I'm trying to say which are our common grounds. Perhaps he would agree with this, and I have also an indication here where he I published for him his email, and he explains that his views is similar to this. Okay, first of all analysis that we are doing for the Hartz phenomenon assume stationarity. Believe it or not, they assume such stationarity. If you estimate the correlation coefficient, you assume stationarity. Second, if you use any model to generate a synthetic series which exhibits the Hartz phenomenon, again, you assume stationarity. But if you visualize any natural or synthetic time series which exhibits this Hartz phenomenon, you will see that the local means vary strikingly from the global mean. These people usually call it non-stationarity, but it's not non-stationarity, because you have assumed that everything is stationary. You see the mean, you see the mean going up by a trend or by a shift, etc. But it is from a stationary model, as I tried to explain with a figure which Andreas presented yesterday. So the Hartz phenomenon is identical with change at all scales, but this change is irregular. That's why it's not stationary, because to have non-stationarity, you need to have a deterministic law that determines this non-stationarity. If it is irregular, it is still stationary, even if you see change, if you use the rigorous meaning of stationarity. So the change that we see in any time series implies some autocorrelation. The autocorrelation is not the cause of this phenomenon. It is just an implication. It is the result of this behavior. And it is unfortunate that autocorrelation has been interpreted as memory by Mandelbrot, and the terms long memory and infinite memory are misleading, but are the most common terms. And I say it's even more unfortunate that 60 years after the Hartz paper and 40 years after Clemens' paper, the term long memory is still the most common name of this behavior. So, Witt explained that it's not the memory, it is the change, whether he called it non-stationarity or... So, there was a second issue that we disagreed strongly, and we continue to disagree, perhaps until 2010. So, this extract from Feller, a mathematician, probabilist, explains, gives the background of our disagreement. He says about the age of people. We hesitate to admit that man can grow 1,000 years old. And yet current actuarial practice admits no bound to the possible duration of life. And he continues to estimate the probability, which is a number with 10 to 27 billion of zeros. This statement does not make sense from a biological or sociological point of view. The rent part of the quotation was used by was quoted by Clemens in his paper. I have the citations in the last slide. But well, Feller continues saying, consider from a statistical standpoint, it certainly does not contradict any experience. And he concludes, if we were seriously to discard the possibility of living 1,000 years, we should have to accept the existence of maximum age and the assumption that it should be possible to live X years and impossible to live X years and 2 seconds is as unappealing as the idea of unlimited life. I guess you understood that it's the discussion like the notion of probable maximum precipitation. Of course, I believe this notion has no scientific grounds. Witt, again, did not like the probabilistic argument. He liked more the physical arguments. So he came up with an analysis of my hate. Well, as you see, he started with an incorrect assumption. I make only one assumption, that you are about 190 centimeters tall. I'm less than 180, sorry. So he took this picture here and zoomed in, and then he comes with this distribution function, and he says, I claim that it would make no sense to estimate probabilities of your heights being, say, 50 or 5 centimeters or 50 meters. Well, in this case, I have a different view. For instance, I can locate a point A here, and I can say this is higher than my hand because I can see the tree behind. So there is an upper bound. In this case, there is an upper bound. I can set an upper bound. And in a similar logic, I can set also a lower bound. So the random variable doesn't go from minus infinity to infinity or from zero to infinity. It is limited in a narrow range. So again, there is no inconsistency between probability theory and common sense. So to see how we continue this discussion, in 2007, he wrote me, so far the two buffers, he means some remedies because he was ill, should keep me in a reasonable distance from strange attractors. You understand what he means by strange attractors. For a while, seem to be working, and the only visible side effects are that I'm now buying more expensive wine. Of course, I also reconfirmed my reservation on Cloud 17. He used this number. Okay, I replied, Cloud 17 can wait. Besides, this is the ultimate destination for all of us. But meanwhile, we hope to see you healthy soon, perhaps in Perugia. And actually, we saw him in Perugia. So he happily replied, I am glad that for once you seem to accept my position and don't say this is the 99.999% sure destination for 99.99 of us. And I said, okay, no need to change my formulation. I said ultimate, which means time tends to infinity. In this case, the probability is exactly one. Anyway, he seems that we found the common grounds because he said, given the physical contents, this is exactly what I wanted to hear. So he was satisfied with my reply. Okay, that's about our relationship, which started at random from this paper, which was actually published by HSJ, but before it was rejected by Journal of Hydrology, and now it's my second most cited paper. Okay, as I said before, Witt had decided not to intervene in hydrology in the 21st century, but again, there are some contributions. First is the book Common Sense and Other Heresies, presented by Gordon before. There is another book, in an imperfect fit. I'll show a slide about this book. There is one only journal paper, which published again in HSJ, which is not about hydrology, but about apocrypha, another Greek word, meaning things that are hidden. I'll explain later. There are some presentations, one in Minnesota, one in Athens, which he gave in my university. I showed you the photo before. The two presentations in Perugia and a final presentation in Prague. And there are some other unpublished documents. All of these are hosted in my website in Itia in Athens. So I have also the citations and the web pages. So this was already presented by Gordon. One note that I like very much that he's suggesting that being heretic is in science is a positive qualification, and I fully agree with this. The other book is an imperfect fit, Advanced Democracy and Human Nature. So it's not about hydrology. It's about politics, it's about religion, it's about philosophy. So he had all these insights, because Witt was a very widely educated person with views about everything in the society. And this is the card that he let me know about his book. So he says, there is life after hydrology. Only one extract. The more the reality diverges from the way prescribed by the ideology, the more ruthless it is forced in the prescribed channel, and the more brutal are the means by which the noble ends are pursued. This, I guess he knew very well, because he was living in Czechoslovakia at difficult times. The paper on Apocrypha, in this paper, he writes several experiences during his career, and he also quotes some anecdotal information. For instance, I have here a quotation by an Irish mathematician, Ken Duffy, which speaks about a digitized version of the Star Wars films and the harsh phenomenon within this digitized time series. Within a space battle, a lot of information is transmitted. Within a love scene, little is sent. So Witt says, comments, while now at last I can better understand why my harsh paper didn't have much impact in hydrology. It had greater impact in other disciplines. It is surely easier to visualize physically caused level shifts between space battles and love scenes than it is between runoff in different time periods. By the way, I have also an annotated version of this paper with all the documents, copies of all the documents. So if anybody is interested to have all this documentation, I can send a copy. He gave me his agreement. Okay. A few words about his talk. This was the association, the invited talk of the association in Perugia. I found this very interesting. A new infectious disease has sprung up, a waterborne schizophrenia. I guess he uses this title to Eddie years later, meaning 20 years after he was president. Okay. On the one hand, we are daily inundated by media with reports about water-caused disasters, from destructive droughts to even more destructive floods, and with complaints that not enough is done to mitigate them, and on the other hand, attempts to do so by any engineering means, and so far no other similarly effective means are usually available, are invariably denounced as rape of nature, and etc., And he says, in the present green propaganda, all dams are evil by definition, writing alongside Chernobyl, Exxon Valdez, rape over the environment, AIDS, cancer, and genocide. Well, just to remind that Vit Clemes was one of the pioneers when he was president, and that's why influential in the Hydrological Society. He supported the vision of hydrology as a science independent of engineering, and asserting that cutting the umbilical cord between the two would be beneficial for both. I disagree with this, and of course I'm not the only one who disagrees. Okay, and he continues. So, as I'll close with a plea to all of you, hydrologists and other water professionals, to stand up for water, hydrology, and water resources engineering to restore their good name, unmask the demagoguery hiding behind the various green slogans. And of course, I fully agree with this. With this later, 20 years after view. Okay, Gordon presented already a few slides from the second presentation. I would say that Salvatore, we organized a session which was the zero Stahi session in Perugia, the zero session, and he was our invited speaker, and he gave this presentation in the zero workshop of Stahi. Here is data disaggregation. And the story is that a year before, he made all this story in a letter. And I encouraged him that this is not the correct way to present this very important stuff. And this should be made in a conference. And fortunately, he agreed and he gave this presentation in our session. One other slide from the same presentation, he speaks about climate change, and he finds two logs from different sites in the same land, and you can see the comparison here, and he says it provides unambiguous proof that two different climates can peacefully coexist in parallel in a mere stone throw apart, at least in our neighborhood, etc. So he had a strong view about climate change, which I fully share, and this was not point of disagreement. This is from his last talk in Prague, where he said political pressures often set the agenda by what is to be or not to be predicted, and sometimes even try to impose the prediction result, thus transforming prediction into prescription. And he also makes the emphasis about the noble cause of saving the planet from climate change. He speaks about the algorithms used for etc. And the last anecdotal information that I want to give here is his reply to the Canadian Geophysical Union about a letter that was prepared by the Canadian Geophysical Union to be sent to the government and the Parliament of Canada. So the request to VIT and to other people, I guess, was to sign this letter. And the letter sent at the Copenhagen Conference, which was in December 2009, the eyes of the world will be on Canada. We, the leaders of the following Canadian scientific societies, urge the government to negotiate an outcome that will rapidly and adequately address climate change. So, Vic replies, no. And he explains the reason. For instance, first of all, the introductory statement is rather arrogant in its exaggeration of Canada's importance in the world. And he continues, the term climate change is a misleading popular slogan. The statement that greenhouse gases resulting from human activities while contributing to the warming of the atmosphere is trivial. Even Suzuki's and Al Gore's farts contribute to it. The exhortation we must act now is cheap unless accompanied with reasonable proposals and priorities for actions. This was in the end of 2009. Witt left us in February 2010. I didn't know that. He left very quietly. So I wrote this letter in May. I made the lecture in GU to the youngsters about how to write a paper. And I used Witt as a model for the youngsters. And I still propose his point of view, his personality. It is a model for the youngsters. And I apologize that I did not send my slides before, and I said I can't rectify. Of course, he did not answer. Okay, I don't have many slides from this presentation, just one, because I sent to the young colleagues that he has some additional skills. For instance, he knows and enjoys wine, which is very important. Okay, that's it. Alberto.